DNA replication evolved twice? That's the question that is asked by an article entitled, Did DNA Replication Evolve Twice Independently? It's written by Lipe, Aravind, and Kunin, and those of you who may remember that Kunin later has written an article saying that in order to get all of the machinery for transcription and translation, that you need multiple universes because it isn't happening in ours. At least it's not expected to happen in ours. The article is in Nucleic Acid Research in 1999. And it's available for free on the internet. You can get it in PDF or in HTML. And in this particular case, I was alerted to the article by a fellow by the name of Marco Penzar, who's from Croatia. And thank you, Marco. They advertise that their articles are chosen by the editors for high impact, as you notice. And I'm going to go through the abstract and then try to see if we can explain what they're looking at. DNA replication is central to all cellular organisms. There are substantial functional similarities between the bacterial and the archaeal eukaryotic replication machineries, including but not limited to defined origins, replication bidirectionality, that is, you can get from RNA to DNA and vice versa, RNA primers and use it in DNA replication, and leading and lagging strand synthesis. All of those things happen in DNA synthesis. However, several core components of the bacterial replication machinery are unrelated or only distantly related to the functionally equivalent components of the archaeal eukaryotic replication apparatus. That is to say that bacteria have one system and archaea and eukaryotes, that's plants, animals, some protists and fungi. They all have the same system, and it's related to archaea, but it's not related to bacteria at all, even though it does the same job. This is in sharp contrast to the principal proteins involved in transcription and translation, which are highly conserved in all divisions of life. There, bacteria and humans have very much the same protein doing the same job. We, the authors, perform detailed sequence comparisons of the proteins that fulfill indispensable functions in DNA replication and classified them into four main categories with respect to the conservation in bacteria and archaea or and eukaryocytes or eukaryotes. One, non-homologous, such as replicative polymerases and primases. They have no relationship whatsoever that we can detect. Two, containing homologous domains. That is, they have a small area that kind of is used in catalysis that's the same, but the rest of the protein's all different. But apparently non-orthologous and conceivably independently recruited to function in replication. Note that word recruited because it's interesting. Where would you recruit it from in a first, in an origin of life scenario? Such as the principal replicative helicases or proofreading exonucleases. 3, apparently orthologous but poorly conserved, such as the sliding clamp protein. That is to say, yeah, there's a lot of sequence similarity, but there's a lot of dissimilarity as well. Maybe more dissimilarity than similarity. Such as the sliding clamp proteins or DNA ligases. And 4, orthologous and highly conserved, that is to say they're virtually the same protein, such as clamp loader ATPases or 3 to 5 exonucleases or flap nucleases. The universal conservation of some components of the DNA replication machinery and enzymes for DNA precursor biosynthesis, some of the outside of things, but not the principal DNA polymerases, suggests that the last common ancestor of all modern cellular life, which is all they can really say because you can't say the first common ancestor because there might have been changes between the first and the last, but you'd have no evidence if that's the case, possessed DNA but did not replicate it in the way extant cells do. This is their conclusion. They're trying to propose that the LCA had a generic system that contained both RNA and DNA, with the latter being produced by reverse transcription. Consequently, the modern type system for double-stranded DNA replication likely evolved independently in the bacterial and archaeal eukaryotic lineages. DNA, to start the article, and the introduction is really helps to set the stage, and we'll look at a few things in the article. DNA replication is an essential central feature of cellular life. There are many important functional parallels among all known cellular systems of DNA replication. You have to replicate DNA, and there's only so many ways to do it, and in fact, it turns out to be fairly similar, but it's more than that. Well, they're going to summarize some common features, some of which might not necessarily have to be that way. These common features can be roughly summarized as follows. Replication is semi-conservative, that is to say you split apart DNA and then you make a new DNA on each side. Replication always initiates at defined origins with the participation of an origin recognition system. It doesn't just start anywhere. It starts at certain specific spots. Replication fork movement is typically bidirectional. It goes, once you pick that spot, it goes both ways rather than just going around one way, which is, of course, more efficient because then you can work on both sides at the same time. 4, replication is continuous on the leading strand and discontinuous on the lagging strand. That is to say, the leading strand, you just keep putting more on. If you're doing the lagging strand, you actually have to go back this way and then peel it off some more and then come back again. And then you have to fuse all those. RNA primers are needed to start DNA replication. Nucleases, polymerases, and ligases replace the RNA primers with DNA and seal the remaining nicks. So there's several things that all life that contains DNA, which is at least on this planet all life, has in common with each other. It is therefore surprising that the protein sequences of several central components of the DNA replication machinery, above all the principal replicative polymerases, the enzymes that actually do the polymerizing, show very little or no sequence similarity between bacteria and archaea eukaryocytes. These observations suggest that some of the replication system's components may not be homologs at all, whereas others, while homologs, are highly diverged. This is in stark contrast to the highly significant sequence similarity between the principal components of the transcription machinery, such as the DNA-dependent RNA polymerase subunits and a number of translation apparatus components. So you're translating to protein. They use the same core enzymes all the way from bacteria to humans. When you're talking about DNA replication itself, the proteins are entirely different. The last 10 years have witnessed significant progress in our understanding of the relationships between proteins and domains involved in DNA replication. Significant sequence similarity between the polymerase-associated proofreading exonucleases of pro and eukaryotes was noted in early studies. The recognition of homology between other replication proteins, where sequence similarity was initially hard to detect, has been made possible by structural comparisons. What that means is that if you just run the numbers, you really don't see it. But if you realize that this has a bend here and that has a bend here, and you find that there tends to be some particular protein at the end of the bend, or some particular amino acid at the end of the bend for both of them, you can see that there's a little bit of sequence similarity that would have escaped your notice otherwise. This was the case for the sliding clamp, 6 and 7, the single-stranded DNA binding proteins, 8 through 10, and the 3 to 5 prime flap endonucleases. No sequence similarity, however, has been detected at all between the principal replicative polymerases, namely the eubacterial family C, eubacteria is just true bacteria, and the archaeal eukaryotic family B polymerases, despite an intense scrutiny at the sequence level. These are proteins that do the same job, but they cannot find any relationship with each other. And despite the increasing availability of polymerase structures, including pol 1 from Escherichia coli and Thermus aquaticus, HIV reverse transcriptase, T7 RNA polymerase, and a family B polymerase from phage RB69. In the same vein, no sequence similarity could be found between the eubacterial and archaeal eukaryotic primases. So there's primases, there's polymerases that just simply don't have any sequence similarity. Thus, the patterns of sequence conservation and divergence displayed by the replication proteins is fundamentally different from the pattern observed in the translation and transcription systems. It seems most likely that the core of the translation and transcription machinery was established in the last common ancestor. Why? Because everything has it, so it must have been descended from that. Of course, it could have been a common plan by the designer, but we're going to leave that out for now. In the last common ancestor of all extant cells, and subsequent evolution in different divisions of life did not involve dramatic alterations of the ancient molecular foundation. Probably why not is because if you alter that enough, it no longer functions, and you can't have a living cell. There's only one way to make DNA into protein, DNA into RNA into protein, but apparently there's at least two completely distinct ways of replicating DNA. In contrast, major changes have occurred in the peripheral components of that transcription-translation system, such as transcription regulators. Conversely, the core replication machinery, including the main replicative DNA polymerase, primase, and the gap-filling polymerase, show no detectable conservation. Several of the peripheral components, however, are clearly homologous or even orthologous. In other words, they have a relationship with each other. The core proteins don't. An obvious, though radical, explanation of the observed disparity is that the last common ancestor did not have a DNA genome and its entire genetic system was RNA-based. That's one way to hypothesize it. This hypothesis, however, does not account for the fact that several proteins involved in DNA replication, as well as enzymes of deoxyribonucleotide biosynthesis and the recombination recombinase A, are homologous in all extant organisms. In other words, all organisms make their DNA in roughly the same way. And so that must have been inherited. But how they replicated it is different. So how do you explain that without some kind of a designer? Well, we're going to go into that. Edgell and Doolittle delineated three distinct scenarios that could explain the existence of two versions of the replication machinery without invoking an RNA-only LCA, last common ancestor. One, the bacterial and archaeal eukaryotic replicative systems have evolved from the LCA replication apparatus, and the main replicative enzymes are actually homologs, but for some reason have diverged rapidly and in several cases beyond recognition. In other words, they started out the same, but as they evolve, they get completely different from each other to where you can't even tell that they once were the same protein. Two, that's one possibility. Two, the LCA possessed both a bacterial type and an archaeal eukaryotic type of DNA replication system. One of these could be responsible for repair. So it had the LCA had duplicate. And the existence of two radically different systems in extant cells is due to differential gene loss. That is, bacteria lost one system and archaea and eukaryotes lost the other system. Three, either the bacterial or the archaeal eukaryotic replication system is the direct descendant of the ancestral replication apparatus, whereas the other version evolved by recruitment of non-homologous proteins accompanied by replacement of ancestral components. Why you would change a perfectly good operating system is not clear. But that's one of the hypotheses that is made. And then the next question is, if that's the case, which was the original, the bacterial or the archaeal? I think most people would say it's not the eukaryotic, humans didn't come first. To reach a clearer understanding of the origins of the DNA replication system by comparative analysis of the sequences and structures of their components, additional systematic effort in two directions seems to be necessary. One, detecting subtle sequence and structural similarities that have escaped detection previously. They're really related, but you couldn't tell it except if you look at it in a certain way. And we'll look at one attempt to do that. And two, solving the issue of orthologous relationships between replication components. That is, which ones came from which. The importance of the former aspect is underscored by the homologous relationships between the bacterial and eukaryotic sliding clamp proteins that was not originally recognized but became apparent when their structures had been determined. With the advent of more powerful methods for sequence analysis, such as PSI-BLAST, the similarity between the clamp proteins has become detectable at the sequence level. And if you're wondering, I looked up resource 7 just for fun, and the abstract, part of the abstract reads, the trimeric PCNA ring is strikingly similar, that would be in structure, to the dimeric ring formed by the beta subunit processivity factor of E. coli DNA polymerase 3 holoenzyme, with which it shares no significant sequence identity. They look the same. The sequence is entirely different. This structural correspondence further substantiates the mechanistic connection between eukaryotic and prokaryotic DNA replication that has been suggested on biochemical grounds. How you show the connectedness by showing that they have entirely different sequences is an interesting question. To come back to our original paper, this suggests that systematic, careful comparisons of replication proteins might reveal additional subtle but evolutionary and functionally important similarities. Such findings could shift the balance in our thinking about the evolution of DNA replication towards the common origin hypothesis, whereas the absence of detectable similarity in spite of a careful comparison might suggest independent origin for at least some of the components. So absence of detectable similarity seems to indicate that it evolved twice. It is critical for any meaningful evolutionary construction to distinguish orthologs that likely evolved from an ancestral component of the replication machinery from homologs, but not orthologous proteins that might have independently originated from proteins that had functions other than DNA replication. Homologous means that they perform the same function, but they're not. Well, actually, homology usually is like the flipper and the hand and the wing that all have the same general bone structure. Right? Okay. In which case, if you're really a good evolutionist, all homologs should indicate orthology. That is, they should indicate that they descended from the same ancestral structure. But here's homologs that don't have orthologs. Kind of like the fin of a shark and the fin of a dolphin, I guess. No? Are there other structures? Kind of like the wing of an insect versus the wing of a bat that have very little to do with each other. So keep in mind that he's using homology as something that is similar but not necessarily descended from the same protein. Or they are. With these considerations in mind, we attempted an exhaustive comparison of the sequences and structures of bacterial, archaeal, and eukaryotic proteins known to be directly involved in DNA replication. We classified these proteins into orthologs, non-orthologous homologs, and those components that appear to be completely unrelated. On the basis of this analysis, we propose a hypothesis that the LCA, the last common ancestor, possessed a genetic system that involved both RNA and DNA, with the latter being produced by reverse transcription. Consequently, the modern type system for double-stranded DNA replication might have evolved independently in the bacterial and archaeal eukaryotic lineages. It happened twice. The fundamental replicative, without which life is not possible. Because if you don't reproduce DNA, well, technically life is not possible, but reproduction is definitely not possible. For all sequence searches, the non-redundancy database at the NIH for biotechnology information was used. The protein sequence similarity searches were performed using the gapped BLAST program and the C-BLAST program. The C-BLAST program constructs a position-dependent weight matrix from multiple alignments generated from the BLAST hits above a certain expectation value, or E value, and carries out iterative database searches using the information derived from this matrix. That's the method, and I want you to notice that E value. That's the expectation value. So what that means is this is a measure of probability. Normally, an E value of 0.01 or 1 in 100 is considered an indication that a database hit is statistically significant. Well, not quite. After regions of low compositional complexity that tend to produce artifactually low E values in database searches have been masked in the query section sequence. So you have to take out some areas because they'll match anything. But then you have these other ones that are complex and that shouldn't match, and if the probability is less than 1 in 100 that they're independent, then you say they're correlated. which is a pretty low bar to hurdle. Compositionally biased regions in protein sequences were masked prior to searches using the SEG program. I'm not going to read the whole thing, and we're skipping over a few areas. Table 1 lists the best database hits from archaean and eukaryotes for the principal bacterial proteins that are involved in DNA replication and DNA precursor synthesis in bacteria and archaea, eukaryocytes. Analogous data for transcription machinery components are included as a control. Only a minority of the bacterial DNA replication machinery components show significant similarity to archaeal and eukaryotic homologs. And here's the actual, well, the data will show you. Some of the strongest hits from bacteria to eukaryocytes, such as those to human NAD-dependent DNA ligase and the Pol-1 homolog from Drosophila, are readily explained by horizontal gene transfer, most likely from organelles. What that says is every once in a while you'll have a human or you'll have a eukaryote that has bacterial genes in it that are doing central important work. And it doesn't have the one that is used for other. And that's explained by horizontal gene transfer. Additional case of likely horizontal transfer, apparently from eukaryotes or archaea to bacteria. So they're bacteria that have the archaea eukaryocyte stuff, are seen in a reciprocal analysis of eukaryotic replication machinery components. These include the B family of DNA polymerases, which are ubiquitous in eukaryotes and archaea, but are so far present only in the gamma proteobacterial lineage. The rest of the bacteria don't have it. And ATP-dependent DNA ligases, which show a sporadic presence in certain bacteria. And they're not showing the data on that, but it's there. Now, here's our table. And you will notice that DNA A, DNA C, DNA B, DNA G, and primase A don't have any archaea or eukaryocyte hits. Zero. This is for E. coli protein, and basically there is no cross. There is no sequence similarity between the same proteins that do it in archaea versus the same proteins that do it in bacteria. And the same way for most of these. Now here's a couple of them that there are some cross-reactive proteins. Accessory replicated helicase, accessory replicated helicase, which means that it's kind of one of the peripheral things. But now these two will appear on the top of the next slide because I couldn't fit it all into one slide and make it readable. And so here is here's some more where it's just completely gone. The clamp loader ATPase fits pretty well. The gap-filling DNA polymerase fits in some cases in eukaryotes but not in archaea. And the same way with this gap-filling polymerase and this RNase HI primer removal. But again, you have a number of ones that are just simply not there in archaea. Well, they're actually there, but the structure is so different that you can't tell that the one is parallel to the other from their sequence. All you can tell is that they do the same job. These cases of apparent horizontal gene transfer apart, that we just got through talking about, the striking contrast between the replication and transcription systems in terms of conservation of the respective components, or lack thereof, in bacteria and archaea eukaryotes is obvious. Although both the replication system and the transcription system include proteins that are highly conserved between bacteria and archaea eukaryocytes, along with ones that show little or no similarities, in other words, both systems have some things that are parallel and some things that are not. But the breakdown of these systems into conserved and distinct components goes along very different lines. In the transcription machinery, the principal subunits of DNA-dependent RNA polymerase show high levels of conservation. The main protein is the same, whereas accessory polymerase subunits and transcription factors are poorly conserved to show no detectable similarity at all. Amongst the replicated proteins, that is the DNA replication, the situation is inverted. The DNA polymerases and primases are not detectably similar, but only some of the accessory subunits, such as clamp-loading ATPases and enzymes that participate in replication but are not components of the replication fork, such as topoisomerase 1, and at least some DNA precursor biosynthesis enzymes are highly conserved. So, in one case, the core is the same and there are changes on the outside. In the other case, some of the outside stuff is the same, but the core is different. To solve the central conundrum in the evolution of replication, common versus independent origins of bacterial and archaeal eukaryotic systems, it is not enough to show that the components of the DNA replication machinery are homologous or non-homologous. This is using homology in a slightly different sense from what it's used usually. Replication of double-stranded DNA poses a number of similar problems in any system, and it would not be unexpected if independently evolving solutions were similar, given that ancient protein superfamilies such as the P-loop ATPases were already available for recruitment in the last common ancestor. The last common ancestor had some other proteins already that could be turned into DNA-producing enzymes. Thus, the goal of comparative analysis of the replication system is to distinguish as best we can between those components that appear to be orthologous and thus should have descended from an LCA protein that had the same function, and those for which, whether they are homologous or not, independent origin is more likely. Maybe they have a few amino acids in the same position, but they're not actually used, the rest of the protein is completely different, and those two are necessary in order to do any kind of DNA manipulation whatsoever, so you kind of have to have them. Proving independent origin is hard, if not at all possible. We're dealing with science, you can't prove anything. The case, however, is strongly supported if, for example, an archaeal eukaryotic protein with a central role in replication is most closely related not to its bacterial functional counterpart. In other words, they're minimally related, if at all, but to a protein family that performs functions outside of replication, which means it could have been recruited from some other protein. The lack of detectable sequence similarity does not automatically mean that the respective proteins are not homologs. There are examples of very subtle relationships between bacterial and archaeal eukaryotic proteins that nevertheless appear to indicate homology or even orthology. See, for example, 36, and we're going to see that in just a bit. Conversely, even highly significant sequence similarities, such as that observed between clamp-loading ATPases, is not necessarily a guarantee of orthology. Now, when you read that, you're going, wait a minute. I thought if they were similar sequences, they had to be. But you see what it says here, highly significant. That means statistically significant, not necessarily sequence number significant. And skipping down, but first I'm going to go to that reference 36, which is Arvind and Kuhn, two of our authors of our paper in 1999, which is the year that this paper came out, and it's in Journal of Molecular Biology, and here they're showing some of the work on their iterative database search, and this one is also available on the net. And just to quote one of the areas, A multiple alignment analysis using the Gibbs sampling procedures indicated that OSGPs and HGSP20 share several conserved motifs with associated probability of chance occurrence in the range of one in a million to one in 10 to the 20th. Now, here's the table one that they referred to, and I'm going to look particularly at these two areas just as a representative so that you get a flavor for how close these now homologous structures are. And here's the first one. And you'll notice that glycine is found here all the time. Isoleucine is found here most of the time in several different kinds of proteins of the same family. Leucine is usually found here, but again, there's occasionally differences. And here's a somewhat conserved area that consists of serine, cysteine, and aspartic acid. But you'll notice that here, it's tyrosine, tyrosine, and histidine, which is entirely different. So it's kind of maybe. Now, serine and threonine are similar, so maybe that's one. Histidine is different. Aspartic acid, of course, is the same. So that's a kind of semi-conserved area. These are all hydrophobic amino acids, isoleucine, isoleucine, alanine, valine, alanine. This one is a glutamic acid, which is entirely different. Alanine and then valine again. So, you know, we're kind of reaching to find similarities. And as you can see, some of these other ones are completely mixed up. Now, here's an interesting one, which has aspartic acid, and then lysine. Completely different charge in the same spot. Aspartic acid, glutamic acid, well, that's pretty close. And then on this particular area here, this is a zinc binding motif, and you'll notice that it has histamine, blah, 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 histamine. Straight down the row. Well, that's two histamine residues apparently have to, histamine is decarboxylated histamine, histidine. And so these ones have histidine. Now, if you're curious, that's what antihistamines are fighting is histamine itself, not histidine, the amino acid. It's the amine without the acid. And but this histidine, these histidine residues have to be there. Well, then occasionally you have extra ones. You have all kinds of stuff that is totally irrelevant in between, but you have to have those histamine or histidine residues just far enough apart so that they can come together and contact to zinc. And so that's kind of a requirement if you're going to use a zinc binding protein. That's orthologous. But as you can see, trying to figure out, I mean, those are completely different in everything except for the two histidine residues, which have to be there. Coming back to our first paper, unrelated components in the bacterial and archaeal eukaryotic replication machineries. That mistake was in both the HTML and the PDF form. This category consists of only four domains, but strikingly, those include all three functional types of DNA polymerases required for replication, namely the DNA polymerase involved in elongation, the primase that is responsible for primer synthesis and hence the initiation of DNA replication, and the DNA polymerase involved in gap filling upon primer removal. So all those DNA polymerases are unrelated. Not only database searches, but also direct comparisons, that is looking at the structures and seeing if there's a loop in both proteins for the bacteria and for eukarya slash archaea, failed to show any sequence similarity between the nucleotide polymerization domain of bacterial DNA polymerase 3 subunit, alpha subunit, and the functionality analogous domain of the archaea in eukaryotic family B DNA polymerases or any other proteins. The same is true of the second archaeal DNA polymerase, polymerase 4, whose large subunit, with the exception of a zinc ribbon domain, which has to have histidine, right, appears to be unrelated to either bacterial or eukaryotic polymerases. So there's no relation. The three-dimensional structures of Pol 3 and Pol 4 have not been determined, and therefore it cannot be ruled out that they have the palm and fingers structure similar to that seen in other DNA polymerases, including the bacteriophage RB69 polymerase, which represents the archaeal eukaryotic family B. However, counterparts to the observed conserved motifs that appear to be shared by the eukaryotes and archaeal DNA polymerases, reverse transcriptions and RNA-dependent RNA polymerases, are not detectable in Pol 3 and Pol 4. This makes a specific evolutionary affinity between bacterial and archaeal eukaryotic DNA polymerases subunits involved in chain elongation during DNA replication most unlikely. These are not likely to be the same. Both types of replicated DNA polymerases possess two additional enzymatic domains that may also function as separate subunits, namely a 3,5-hexanuclease and predicted phosphoesterase. This, I think, came from the PDF, and it was translated straight into HTML. The hexanuclease domains are related but may not be orthologous, as discussed below. In contrast, the phosphoesterase domain subunits belong to two distinct enzyme superfamilies, namely the PHP superfamily in bacteria and the calcineurin type superfamily of metal-dependent phosphoesterases in archaea and eukaryotes, which show no indication of a homologous relationship. So these are more closely related to other proteins than they are to each other. And related is a very, you know, they're not telling you 30% sequence similarity or things like that. DNA primases present a case where an independent origin of the bacterial and archaeal eukaryotic enzymes appear to be supported by positive evidence as well as the lack of the detectable sequence similarity. The catalytic domain of bacterial primases shows a subtle but statistically significant sequence similarity. Subtle but statistically significant. So we're talking, you know, maybe 80% divergence, but it's statistically significant to the DNA nicking rejoinder domains of type 1, type 2, and type 4 topoisomerases, and a distinct group of nucleases. All these proteins are predicted to contain the conserved topoisomerase domain. Despite a careful search, we were unable to detect any similarity to the topoisomerase domain in the sequence of eukaryotic primases. So the bacterial is similar to topoisomerase domains, the eukaryotics are not. The fact that the bacterial primase has shown apparent structural and evolutionary relationship not only with their... So notice, they assume so much. You see, the probability is low that this could happen by chance, therefore it must have happened by evolution. That's the logic. Similar design is just simply not even considered. The fact that bacterial primates has shown apparent structural and evolutionary relationship not only with their archaeal eukaryotic functional counterparts, but with enzymes that have significantly different, even if mechanistically related, functions, seems to effectively rule out an origin of the two types of extant primases from an ancestral primase. They must have been two different primases to begin with. Finally, the bacterial gap-filling DNA polymerase Pol 1 appears to be unrelated or at best extremely distantly related, with the exception of 3,5-hexanuclease domain, to any other DNA polymerases, whereas eukaryotes utilize family B DNA polymerases for both elongation and gap-filling. Now, homologous but not orthologous components of the DNA replication apparatus in bacteria and archaeal eukaryocytes. These are things that do the same job, have some of the same structure, but most of it is not, and they don't think that they descended from each other. Several important components of the DNA replication machinery in bacteria and archaea eukaryocytes, while homologous, are strong candidates for independent recruitment for a role in replication. And they give some examples. I'm not going to read them all. Thus, the principal replicative helicases seem to be an irrefutable case of independent drawing of enzymes from the pool of P-loop ATPases for a central function in DNA replication. And skipping on down, the ssDNA binding proteins represent another case of homologous domains that apparently have been independently recruited to perform a similar function in archaea, eukaryotic, and bacterial lineages. So here's two more divergent proteins. And moving along further, other proteins and domains, namely archaeal, eukaryotic, FEN1, RAD2 nucleases, and bacterial 5-3 exonuclease domains of polymerase 1, the replication sliding clamps, and DNA ligases, the NAD-dependent ligase in bacteria and the ATP-dependent ligase in eukaryotes, show very low sequence conservation, but nevertheless appear to be orthologs. So they're way different, but they're enough similar that it looks like they came from the same protein, at least if you assume that they had to evolve from each other and could not have been designed separately. Until recently, the homologous relationships between these components of the replication machinery remained undetected. We used to think they were totally unrelated. Well, now we think, well, they must have been related. But they're that poorly related to each other. However, detailed sequence comparisons as well as structural superposition for the sliding clamps and the ligases indicate that in each of these cases, the bacterial and archaeal eukaryotic proteins are homologous. Moreover, apparent horizontal gene transfers apart, the bacterial proteins in each of these cases are more similar to their functional counterparts from archaea eukaryotes than to any other archaea or eukaryotic proteins. So this is a place where they're using the same stuff. These observations suggest that orthologous relationships exist for each of these proteins in spite of the high-level divergence. That is, they don't really look like each other, but they're so, well, they're kind of half similar to each other. And the half similarity must have been because they were related, because it's unlikely that it would have been hit on accidentally on both sides. Hypothesis: a mixed RNA-DNA genetic system in the LCA. And I'm just going to skim over this. There are proteins that are homologous but apparently have been independently recruited, and a core of polymerase that seem to be unrelated. And how can this mixture of ancestral and independently acquired features of DNA replication be accounted for? And they're going to give three examples. One, the LCA already has a DNA genome like modern-day cells that was replicated by DNA. In other words, we had a modern system. Two, the LCA had an RNA component and a DNA component, with the DNA being transcribed into RNA and the RNA being reverse transcribed into DNA, that you had a half DNA, half RNA molecule. Or if you want to think of it that way, a single-stranded DNA, single-stranded RNA. Given the orthology and high conservation of core components of the eubacteria and archaeal eukaryotic transcription machinery, several components of the replication machinery itself and the RCA, the first possibility seems unrealistic. It's not likely to be all in RNA. The LCA must have been able to synthesize and make use of DNA. The second model must also somehow explain the lack of orthology and, in several cases, any detectable homologous relationship, whatever, between the key components of the DNA replication apparatus in bacteria compared with archaea and eukaryocytes. As already mentioned, such explanations would involve one or more of the three main themes. You either have to do the principal components of the DNA replication are in fact orthologous, but have diverged beyond recognition. Or there's been non-orthologous displacement of some but not other components recruited from elsewhere. Or the LCA possess two partially independent DNA replication systems that have been unequally eliminated in the different lineages. And the third option, namely a differential loss of one of the two DNA replication systems, is perhaps most difficult to refute, however, in addition to being based on an unlikely assumption that the replication systems of the LCA was considerably more complex than modern ones. This hypothesis also runs into problems with non-orthologous displacement mentioned above, in this case with regard to DNA repair machinery. Indeed, comparative analysis of the proteins involved in DNA repair reveals an extreme diversity of the repair systems in bacteria and eukaryocytes. As an alternate to all these explanations, they're going to propose their own. The modern systems, the type systems for double-stranded DNA evolved independently in bacteria and archaeal eukaryotic lineage. In the proposed model, the LCA did not have a replicating DNA genome, but instead maintained a mixed DNA RNA genome that had the following basic properties. Genomic RNA was reverse transcribed into an RNA-DNA heteroduplex by reverse transcriptase. Then the RNA moiety was chopped up. Then the remaining single-stranded DNA made double-stranded DNA. And then the RNA was transcribed by a kind of a standard procedure. My own take on all this is it would seem to be extremely difficult to explain how life could evolve without any guidance. Central to that difficulty is the problem of minimally complex genome. You have to have so much of a genome in order to make it work. You have to make the components for DNA, and you have to have DNA replicate itself. I mean, that's kind of minimal. Well, maybe RNA replicate itself, but something that can do that. The data in this paper seems to indicate that the core enzymes involved in DNA duplication evolved twice. That is, of course, assuming no intelligent design. And that would seem to double the difficulty involved. You've got to evolve it. You've got to evolve it again completely independently. If the evolution of one is like 10 to the minus 1,018 or whatever it is, then you're talking 10 to the 2,036 or whatever it is. The proposal favored by the paper we've talked about seems to be that there was a third way of duplicating DNA using RNA, which has not survived to the present. Thus, the DNA duplicating machinery, in fact, involved three times. Since we have no extant organisms with this mechanism, it is not clear whether the bacterial or the archaeal eukaryotic machinery is more closely related to the primitive machinery. But in any case, even if one of them is more closely related, they're not identical. In any case, the finding of statistically significant correlations between proteins seems a weak way to infer an evolutionary relationship. If they're like 90% divergent, how can we say that that extra 10 is, it proves that there's a relationship? In order for there to be a Darwinian relationship between two highly divergent proteins, Protein A must be able to be transformed into protein B by single steps, all the while retaining its catalytic activity, because if it loses its catalytic activity, the cell dies. Finally, recruiting proteins from another superfamily seems unlikely. The DNA replication machinery would seem to have come first, and then would have had to been recruited for the other job rather than recruited for DNA. Now, I suppose you could say the last common ancestor was horribly complex, but in that case, it sounds like the last common ancestor was designed to evolve, in which case you've got design in your picture anyway, and you've lost the argument for having everything the way it is. But that's my opinion. Now it's your turn. Sure.
The last common ancestor. What kind of thing was that?
They don't know.
Oh.
He's proposing that the last common ancestor had RNA that was made into DNA, that was made into double-stranded DNA, that was transcribed into protein.
And this happened long before animals or plants or humans?
Right. Right.
Way, 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 way back when?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Once upon a time, a long time ago.
I see.
I would raise the question, if you have a common ancestor, supposedly, they would... You have a system that works.
Why change it to another one?
Why are you going to evolve another one?
And no, another two.
But and you've got to, I mean, so you're going to have one and you're going to replace it, destroy the one and replace it with a new one?
The question is, why bother having bacteria if you've already got archaea?
Exactly. I mean, this is... a desperate attempt to stay within a secular interpretation.
It is. It's more than that. To say that because it's statistically unlikely that they would have started independently doesn't prove that they evolved from each other. It suggests that maybe they were designed with a common characteristic rather than evolved. But see, the question of design is completely gone from the paper, which is okay. I mean, that's their worldview, but you can see the difficulties that it creates.
It's a rather strong case in favor of creation.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, we have intelligent minds here, I assume. Constantly making phrases and statements that, well, this is not related to that, we can't see where the connection is, and on and on, it's almost endless. They can just grab something that they've been able to find out how it's composed. But theorizing all these changes, they have absolutely no idea. Evolution's totally undefined. I mean, at least Charles Darwin said it happened by so-and-so process. But how did all this stuff get to be the way it is? And if they can't figure it out, and they got a genius IQ, let's say, then there's somebody out there that's a lot, lot smarter than they are. I mean,
either
infinitely
that, yeah,
smarter.
It boggles the mind that a blind process can beat...
hundreds of times more intelligent than Einstein.
Yeah, it just the it's more no, you look at
it's
it,
totally
the more
nonsensical.
You say this just. I mean, it's one thing when it's complex, and it evolved once, but then when you start and do it all over again using entirely different sequences. I mean. It's hard enough to believe that if you turn on your computer and turn it off and save the ones and zeros that you get, eventually you'll get to Windows.
Well, it's bad.
But what really boggles the mind is that you not only get Windows, but you get Mac at the same time.
No matter how you... I don't know how you're going to explain this from an evolutionary perspective.
Maybe this is what forced Kunin into saying there are multiple universes.
Well, that's a myth. That's not scientific.
Well, of course it's not scientific. But it gives you an idea of the problem that you're dealing with, which is they don't want God in there. And so they have to find something that will fit.
But
and even if it fits poorly, it's where you're forced to go if you don't have a designer.
If you've got a system that works there, how are you going to have any survival value from adding a system that has to develop gradually? that's going to be an encumbrance because it does not function until it's fully developed.
Well, that's supposing I wish I'd looked it up, but supposing that DNA polymerase has 300 amino acid residues in it. I don't know what it is. Let's supposing that 250 of them are divergent, which means 50 of them are convergent, and really there's a lot of relationship there. As we're reading here, it sounds like it's worse than that. Well, of course, they do mask the common stuff, so maybe it isn't quite. But let's say we're dealing with 250 different.
Okay.
What you're saying is that you can get a change in one amino acid and it'll still work, and you change another amino acid and it still works, and you change another amino acid and it still works, and there is a chain all the way of 250 different amino acids.
And you have to have survival value over a system that doesn't have all that encumbrance around there.
All of those changes don't destroy the enzymatic activity, because if they do, the animal can't live, or the living creature, whatever it is, plant, animal, bacteria. The weirdest part is that you don't have this continuum now. That is to say, it worked once upon a time, but it doesn't work now, and now we have these two ends and nothing in the middle. The more you look at it, the weirder it gets.
Many years ago, an allegation was made against Bush 1 in the U.S. Congress. So someone stood up and says, lack of proof is not the proof of its absence. If we cannot prove something, it doesn't mean that it was not there. You see, I mean, why waste all this time? I believe that some folk who are very intelligent says, we are not created, we made ourselves, you see. And that's why, even this is beyond argument, but we still want to make arguments. And just like the couple of weeks ago, you made the presentation, or was it last week? Well, red wine is great. So what do you tell 19-year-old kid? Red wine is great, doesn't matter whether it's proved or not. You know, never mind the red grapes, you know, just go ahead and drink the wine. That's the way to go. How many millions and millions of minds they have blown and people they have caused death of, doesn't matter. You see, the same way here, we're trying to find something that's really was not there and we cannot prove it, but even then, never mind the creator, we created ourselves. You see, that seems to be what is going on. Many rails are flagged.
Yeah, it's really amazing to think about. I guess until there's further evidence of an overwhelming character to these people, I'm content to let God deal with them. But it does seem like it's not really. It's not really fair to say that a person who believes that there's a creator behind this is not playing fair with the evidence, because it seems to me like the shoe's on the other foot. That they're the ones that are really kind of straining against the evidence.
Right.
And what I am hoping to do by exposing this kind of stuff is to have people look at it and say, you know what, there is a good case for believing in a creator.
Yes.
And then have people say, well, if there's a creator, maybe he has, he desires a relationship with his creation, and then start from there and say, well, you know, what does he have to say? And pay extra attention to it. But see, the fundamental thing that this is being used to do is to tear people apart from the belief that there's a creator. And therefore, you don't have to worry about the Bible. You don't have to worry about any of that kind of stuff. You don't have to ask what kind of a God is God, because he doesn't exist. Or at least, if he exists, at least he's not active in the universe.
Ineffectual.
I'm sorry. We have a comment here and then back. Oh, okay.
Thanks. Seems to me this paper is sort of like a smoke screen because they've gone on to all this tremendous amount of work with the databases and whatnot and carefully looking at all this stuff. But what about the first question that, how did the polymerase even evolve in the first place?
Yeah, what about the first common
ancestor?
Yeah,
the first time, because it's like insurmountable, right? It's a complicated system and what do they call it? Irreducibly complex, I'd say. So.
Well, you know, what's fun to do is to take this and put it together with the nitrogen cycle and realize that the last common ancestor couldn't have lasted for too long because otherwise it would have run out of nitrogen or be swamped in ammonia or something like that.
Yeah, so they're just avoiding it.
Because you need both kinds of creatures, you know, to fix nitrogen and also to get rid of the waste. Mm-hmm. And so there probably whatever was a last common ancestor in that situation. In which case this act life arose twice. Well, how many times did life arise? Well, maybe it was created.
Right.
You know, I would actually, if I were pushed into that kind of position, I would prefer an old earth creationist position to an atheistic position because they just don't have the numbers. I mean, you saw those little short areas of DNA where, except for the two histidines, they were virtually divergent all the way across. Mm-hmm. Virtually 100%. I mean, if you look at it, 5%, you should have 5% concordance if you just slap two proteins together. Because 120 proteins should make it. And of course, if glycine is more common than other proteins and alanine is also more common than other proteins, then what you would expect actually is more than 5% convergence because of the overlap of common amino acids. So you're probably looking at about 10 or maybe 20% before you even start getting excited. And, you know, they're trying and they're giving, you know, getting numbers of 1 in 1,000,000. Well, what about 1 in 10^74 power? I mean, when does this kind of stuff get ridiculous? Well, I don't think it was originally intended to be a cover-up for We Don't Know. And that's an important point, is that at first they thought that they'd actually hit upon the answer. But when you start digging into the numbers, it just doesn't fit. And so now it has turned into We Don't Know. And frankly, we can't figure out why. And if they're really pushed to do this, one amino acid at a time and still preserving the function all the way down to the 250 amino acid divergence. And I don't care if you have multiple pathways. It doesn't matter. Because even if you could go two different ways, the chances of getting making everything work on each step goes down tremendously. They don't have pathways. They don't have them. They just think they might have them. And this is really important. Now, in bacteria, you can skip about six neutral steps. But in humans, you can't skip six neutral steps. You can't skip more than one neutral step because one neutral step happens every 160 million years or something like that, according to their own statistics, Dirt and Schmidt. Dirt and Schmidt should never have published that paper.
In humans, a recent paper by Sanford and Baumgartner and so on, they're suggesting, as I recall, that to get two mutations in order would take 80 million years.
Well, Behe suggested several billion years. And then Durrett and Schmidt said, no, you're wrong. It's only 160 million years.
And we're supposed to have evolved from chimpanzees 5 million years ago.
That's why I say Durden and Schmidt, if they were playing the long game, they would never publish that paper. Because now we have an official estimate that passed peer review that nobody has actually criticized the numbers on that says it just isn't happening. That you are given maybe, if you're really lucky, one extra mutation before it has to be useful. So you, each mutation that happens has to be useful. And that just isn't happening.
I think this is an example of how science has trapped itself into a secular philosophy, a naturalistic philosophy, and so on. And it doesn't work. They've got to open up the door and let some other ideas in here.
I agree.
Nowhere fast.
I agree.
I believe that this is a design by a counterfeit. You see, our salvation is by our choice. And so Satan is saying, well, vast majority of people will choose the false thing because it looks more attractive. That's how it is happening. Well, it's all in scientific journals, so you've got to believe in it because it's there. You mentioned Behe. Does Michael Behe now? Is he a believer now? Does he believe now? Does he believe that there's a creator?
What's happened with the Discovery Institute is that they just welcomed Durrett and Schmidt's paper. And Behe says, okay, have it, instead of 9 billion years, have it 160 million years. We can live with that, That if you go back, we have we actually had a discussion of that called "Don't Mess with ID," about a year ago or so, I guess. That outlines exactly what happened with that, and it's just an amazing thing. Once they actually have to deal with the numbers, it falls apart. And I think there's a number of areas where that's true. And, part of our job when we're discussing science is to pull it out of this kind of, well, it could have happened this way, it could have happened this way, and say, well, okay, I need details on that. What's the probability? What are the steps involved? Because the fact of the matter is they don't have any. It's all basically fairy tales.
Yeah, what I was asking you is that Michael Behe, I understand that initially he did not believe that there's a creator, but he says this is irreducibly complex. This has to be. But does he believe now that there is really someone behind the whole thing?
He was taught actually in Catholic school. Yeah. He was Catholic. He went to school in Catholic schools, and they taught him that God created the universe and then he allowed it to evolve. And he didn't really interfere until humans came along, and then he intervened in history. But he actually kind of let the process go. And then he started seeing this, and he started seeing this, and he said, and then he came to the origin of life. He said, no way, no way. And, he still believes in long ages. He still believes in common ancestry even. But he doesn't believe that it happened by chance, that there was a guiding force that kind of helped it along. And see, if you have design, then that is one option for design. But the very idea of saying design out loud and saying that that put him in big trouble. Just a minute. Yes.
Paul had problems with this. Romans 1. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven, blah, blah, blah. Ever since the creation of the world, his eternal power and divine nature, invisible though they are, have been understood and seen through the things he has made. So they're without excuse. So, for though they knew God, they did not honor him as God or give thanks to him, but they became futile in their thinking and their senseless minds were were darkened. Claiming to be wise, they became fools. Yes. So this is an age-old issue.
And then I think it goes on to say God gave them up.
And they exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images resembling a mortal human being. Da, 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 da. Therefore, God gave them up in the lusts of their heart.
Yeah, no. Yeah, and to think that Paul could say that, we can say it so much with so much more detail.
We have much more evidence.
Yeah.
I think one of the interesting points of that text that was just read here is that some honored God, but they didn't honor him as God. In other words, you give just a nominal nod to God. This is not enough. You're going to fall into this trap.
Yeah.
Verse 28 is interesting. And since they did not see fit to acknowledge God, God gave them up to a debased mind and to things that should not be done.
Yes, and we're seeing that today.
And homosexuality is right.
Yes, yes.
There's a whole list of things. Envy, murder, strife, deceit, craftiness, da-da-da.
Yeah. It's not, yeah. And by the way, this might happen in science. And it might be the reason why people feel that it's okay to cheat in science is because there's no controlling authority.
Well, you've got all the things that you find on the net.
Yeah. Anyway, hopefully next week we'll have something for you. We'll detail it when I figure out what it is, and we'll give you we'll send it to you by email.